Welcome everybody. We have a fantastic panel to discuss metadata and HVD. Before we get into the details, this is an event that is being hosted by HasGeek, your favorite community platform for the tech community. My name is Venkat Singhali, and I'm from a company called Scribble Data. And we are a machine learning product firm. I think this week has been busy. This is the fifth day of the NPD week. The purpose of this entire week is to discuss the committee report of the non-personal data committee that has been constituted to look at data sharing and growth in the data economy overall. So last 5 days, we have been discussing various aspects of it. We had several committee members also join us to discuss the evolution of their own thinking, what is the larger international context around this proposal, and of course, the community framing and data trustees. So today, we are going to focus on a little more of the mechanistic part of this. Organizations within this particular NPD framework are supposed to share their metadata with a non-personal data authority, a body that will be created as part of this law. And organizations can discover data sets and also source them. They have a particular structure, which is the data trustees who are authorized to do this. The discussion today revolves around the metadata. What will get shared? How will it shared? Can we do it in a robust manner? Can we do it in a in a manner that keeps the trust of the entire data ecosystem? And also the particular concept or construct that the NPD committee has introduced, which is the HVD, high value data set. And so we'll explore these HVDs as well. To discuss all of this, we have a fantastic panel with us. We have Prashanto Roy, who is a technology writer and a public policy consultant. He will open by framing the overall issues within the narrow scope that we are looking at. We will then have respondents share their perspective. We have Ish from Zendrive, Mangalam from ThoughtWorks, and Shubhashish from Umadiyar. I will give a little more background about them and the some of the questions that they could respond to. But we will open first with Prashanto. Prashanto, the floor is all yours.
Thanks, Venkat. Delighted to be on this panel. And I'll jump quickly in and I'll try to keep this short. We've probably all been through lots of discussions on the NPD and metadata and all of that. But I think it's just worth reiterating once at the outset how valuable metadata is. And it's often more valuable than data. And, it really is worthwhile reiterating that with multiple examples, simply with even with phone call records, where, you might actually be able to, supposing you were hypothetically able to tap into phone calls, randomly and listen in, there's very little value to that compared with what you can do with aggregated live metadata of all those, people who are calling, who are they calling, how frequently is a group of people calling, let's say a neighboring country, Pakistan, how many people are calling particular clusters of shops which sell meat, so you can do a lot of stuff with that metadata, which makes it really worrying. And I think we've heard many, many examples of how valuable that metadata is across the various discussions. So clearly, it is frequently underrated and it's held to a lower bar, a lower kind of standard than data, which is unfortunate, you know, even for law enforcement access, etc. Metadata is considered, you know, it's pretty cool. Various, you know, court order required for phone tap order, etc. So therefore, you know, it really is worthwhile looking at how the abuse can happen, and therefore, what are the concerns and questions which would potentially be settled by maybe a non-personal data authority. But then we will come to that issue in a while about the regulatory capacity, because I expect to see a fair bit of challenges and questions and actually landing up with the authority. And let's kind of see how. So, you know, clearly, I think the some of the examples we've heard, there are many potential public good causes for demanding metadata from different entities. There's also a bunch of reasons which could be, for example, comparative issues, you know, for antitrust related things. So frequent examples are there of the large platforms which have a significant degree of dominance, which can be seen in terms of, for example, let's say an Amazon or Flipkart has an insights on so much of sales metadata, the aggregated metadata telling it exactly what is selling, how is selling, and so on. And therefore, they can use that to launch their own brand name products. And therefore, they have an unfair edge, and they actually will edge down other partners and others who are trying to sell those products. And, you know, you'll get to see Amazon Basics and Solimo and all these products showing up. And we've seen that happening. But I mean, clearly, and this I've said before, and I think that in the same an opening session of this NPD week, that you have various ways of tackling that. So that's something that's just to park on the side. You know, you've got the Competition Commission, you've CCI, you've got the other frequently used tool and instrument for that, which is, well, basically the body, DPIIT, or DIPP, as it was known earlier, the Ministry of Commerce's thing, which issues these press notes, you know, which basically define restrictions or which define the conditions on which the entities in e-commerce who take FDI will be bound by. And we'll probably see one of those actually tackling this issue of platforms being invested in their sellers. Okay, so my point is, you know, without going too deep into that, there are many ways of tackling the antitrust, the competitive, other challenges without having to resort to a forced sharing of data, which obviously the company will consider very, very valuable, the company itself, whichever is being forced to share it, and will obviously, you know, bring up challenges. Legal challenges in every year with the NPD, NPDA, and maybe cases will land up in court and so on. So clearly, the willingness of companies to part with metadata, which is exceptionally valuable to them, and you know, it becomes an open access metadata directory, that is going to be really troubling for companies. So I think that's really one big question. While saying that, okay, sure, there are public good causes which you can argue would be a good thing, you know, for public health or for a bunch of other things, but you've got to look at both the potential hit on businesses, which will actually cause challenges, and since we are here to discuss practical challenges, this is one clearly to leave out there on the table. The proxy issues of, you know, a company setting up you know, another entity which is Section 8 company, and then it sets up a high value database ostensibly for another public good cause or for you know, helping with the community or whatever it is, but essentially it seeks data from other data businesses. And that's not hypothetical, because, you know, you could already have Section 8 companies out there which can actually demand such data, some of which maybe it already has access to, and there are concerns about that. And I think we've, you know, in fintech, for example, NPCI is one example, which is actually a competitor on certain areas. It is competing with card companies. It's competing with payment system providers, with PPIs, with wallets, etc., with the entire UPI platform. And that's why RBI has now pitched for an alternative framework, the NUE framework, so that other platforms can also emerge, which don't, which is not bound by this one dominance. My point is, this is not the only example, but, you know, fintech, which I work a lot with, you know, is fairly sort of obsessed with this example, and for possibly good reason. So I think finally, maybe a couple of quick points for startups. You know, there would be concern emerging about the compliance burden. Now, startups are ironically, I mean, startups are very quick and nimble on their feet on lots of things, but they're very, very slow to recognize policy challenges. And one of the reasons is they don't really believe they have a lot of role to play in terms of, you know, engaging with policy and trying to shape policy. They feel they're too small to be able to make an impact. But I think all startups and small businesses and all of those have recognized the kind of compliance burden they faced with a change like GST. And, you know, this, I mean, that's, you ain't seen nothing yet. If they have to comply with a bunch of new policies around data, which include the PDP bill related issues and, you know, the liabilities that will emerge from that, and then the compliance burden of NPD. Now, there's obviously some benefits that they'll potentially derive because they'd be very probably looking forward to data from the biggies, from the Paytms and Ubers and Zomatos and Swiggies and so on, and to be able to leverage that. But they too will have a compliance burden, and you know they need to be kind of really aware of that. I mentioned this before, and I'll just repeat that all of this will end up with quite a few challenges which keep going up to the regulatory authority. And we've seen regulatory capacity bottlenecks in multiple areas, you know, whether it's telecom, where there is a very significant capacity out there and it still keeps getting challenged. The RBI itself, again, huge organization. Okay, we really need to see how quickly an NPDA, you know, in the coming few years would be able to set up and really ramp up capacity and scale. You know, and here I have not even looked at the potential social harms, and I did mention the possibility of abuse of metadata. Clearly, you know, there's a lot that can happen with that metadata, and that could be initially it could be sought for a public good, high value data set. And this again is, I think, an example that we have discussed in perhaps earlier discussions of this type. For example, for public health, you know, you look at identifying clusters where there are red meat eaters, and you know, you map them to disease, and you know, to clusters where there is high chronic cardiac issues and things like that. But equally, you know, those clusters are also clusters where you could have people targeted for their dietary habits, and that's not a hypothetical issue anymore in India, unfortunately. That has happened a fair bit over the last few years. Targeting, I mean, not necessarily based on NPD analytics. So if it is done, you know, and I fully, you know, given the direction that a lot of policymaking is going, I mean, there is some consultation and so on. But by and large, I think we've seen a fair bit of what I could call national interest prevailing. And national interest today seems to believe in this, you know, this concept of sovereign data, et cetera. So the, you know, state decides on data. Data is, you know, a national good, et cetera. And that's been contested and so on. But I fully expect to see some form of this actually go through. So I think one would really like to see transparency, very clear transparency about the public good basis, which high value data set is initiated and created, a clear statement of purpose, and a discussion around possible alternative uses of that data, so that there is a strong assessment of the harms which are possible. Harms from a public good and a societal point of view, of course. And then there is the issue of the harms to the company in terms of their business, protection of the IP that directly affects business. You know, favorite examples for data use and metadata use are of Uber, and you know, you can use that Uber metadata to do town planning and all of that. But the fact is that yes, it's open to use and interpretation by potential competitors, and those competitors could be, you know, ostensibly public good kind of competitor. I mean, for example, they could be city transport, or they could be to improve the you know, the planning and coordination of the Delhi Metro or the Delhi service or something. But it could equally be for other competitors in that. So clearly an assessment of the impact of that. And Uber, believe me, Uber or Ola or all of them, will do this assessment and will challenge data demands or high HP data set demands, which very clearly and visibly affect their business potentially, or let their proprietary IP and data be visible to competitors. So that's a kind of a quick overview, and I leave the floor open for the others for intervention.
I think that is fantastic. I mean, you talked about two big themes. One is the trust, trust as far as legitimate users, directing this in the right fashion. And the other one that you talked about is the complexity because of the far-reaching nature of this particular change. It will touch every nook and corner, and that will have second-order effects in terms of exposing the capacity limitations in the system. Now, given the commitment to this direction, I have one question before I want Subhashish to respond on the larger trust and the incentive issue. This is going to be step change, no matter when it is done, now or 3 years from now, and this seems to be the larger direction in which the world is going. So you talked about transparency as one of the tools this will help with in this journey, transparency as far as the objectives, processes, and so on. Any other, given that we have to take this step change, any other thoughts come as far as process that will help with this, ease this transition?
So, you know, I think it's related to the transparency angle in a couple of ways. So one is the capacity. I mentioned the capacity building for the regulatory authority. Okay, but to go back to the transparency issue, it's not enough to just say that there should be transparency. Okay, who's going to question the transparency? So just as an example for a policy, for a public policy development process, you know, transparency requires that there is consultation, there is a, you know, draft, and that draft is, responded to, etc. But for an individual request for a high value data set, okay, if there is no transparency, or if there is a stated purpose, but there could be alternative use cases which lead to harms, okay, then, I don't see currently in place a plan to have to ensure that form of transparency, because you clearly are not going to have a consultative process for every request, right? So it's going to be up to the NPD authority to be able to adjudicate on that and to look deeper. So possibly a process of feedback there, which may not be in line in the sense it won't lead to a delay in the approval for that particular thing. But when it comes up and, you know, this is brought up to the public that this was the stated purpose, there should be a process to absorb that feedback. Okay, I think that is a non-trivial process. That's why when I just say transparency, it's one word, but it means to a whole SOP out there, which, you know, really takes thinking.
I think this is wonderful. At this point, I want to bring in a few different perspectives because of the emphasis of Prashanto on the systems aspects, the design aspects of this particular space. I will change the order a little bit and start with Subhashish. Subhashish is a principal at Omadiyar Network India and invests in both for-profit and non-profit entrepreneurs with the aim of helping create a safe digital society. He writes extensively on data protection, internet governance, digital ID, and regulatory design. And with the breadth of experience that he has and the thought that he has given, Subhashish, I want you to comment on three questions that I'm going to pose that emerged out of earlier conversations and also Prashanto's presentation. We know that there are significant concerns around the overall architecture, whether it is the NPDA, the design and the incentives of them, or in terms of potential leaky anonymization methods, the malactors, and so on. The question is, how do you create a trustworthy non-personal data ecosystem? That is the first problem. The second problem is how that still does not assume that or does not require that organizations are aligned. How do you create incentives for organizations to be good actors in this entire space? And lastly, do you believe that the data trustees and the architecture that is proposed today, is it enough? Or do you feel that there are further refinements that need to be done going in the larger directions of trust?
Okay, thanks, Venkat, for those questions. And I'll probably take them in that sequence. Before I do so, the underlying theme in whatever I'm about to say is building off Prashanto's point around regulatory capacity. And if you look at what has been written on this topic, especially referring to Ajay Shah and Vijay Kelkar's book, in cases like India, where regulatory capacity is low, you typically try to make it as rule-based and as less discretionary as possible. And therefore, I think that is what we have to aim for if we have to make this entire system work. So let me take that question of trust through every element of the data journey. So the data as it is with the, you know, the data custodians or the businesses that give data, I think is something you will probably discuss later in the event in a lot more detail about metadata and what are the practical challenges there. So I'll skip that bit. Next, there is a data trustee who mandatorily can ask for data for non-personal data from businesses. There are, as of now, not too many checks and balances around what the roles and the functions and the accountability of this kind of data trustee. And I think building off the point of transparency that Prashanto spoke about, I think that's very important. For example, some of the things that should practically be done is that the data trustee should have a mandate that every year it's putting out an annual report. Because if you're serving a public good function, you should be better, you know, you should be open to the public. You're saying, what are the HVDs you created? Who asked for access, et cetera, et cetera? So that we can make sure that data trustees are performing well. Next step in the data value chain is that the data that the data requester is asking the data trustee for data. And I think this is where some of the incentive questions or discretionary questions become important, in the sense that the data trustee is meant to ensure that this data is being used for public good. But at the same time, it's supposed to be non-discriminatory in its in providing access. Now, how does this, so this question of does the data trustee really have any discretion on who it provides this data to is somewhat unclear, and one might even say contradictory. And therefore, my suggestion is, given that we really do care about the non-discrimination probably more than other things, that the data trustee have a mandate to mandatorily share data with whoever asks for it, unless they have a problem with it, and in which case they can take it to the NPDA and have that argued out in courts. But I think to provide more discretion to the data trustee in terms of who they can give access to and who they can't probably creates a lot of possibility for the data trustee to actually, in that sense, be owned by vested interests. And finally, the question is, in the final leg of this trust, when it reaches the data requester, at that point, how do you make sure it is being used for the public good purposes? And how do you trust the data will be used well? And I think this is a very big challenge, because you obviously don't want a very heavy-handed regulation that is monitoring each and every user. As Prashanto said, you can't have a public consultation process on each and every request like that. So you will have to make it somewhat free-flowing, but then you have to have post-facto checks to ensure and mechanisms to ensure that data has not been used in a misleading way. And for that, for example, I think the kinds of things that will be important is that there should be clearly laid out penalties for misuse, that there should be a quasi-judicial arm of the NPDA, because that's where most of Indian regulators miss a lot, which is they don't have a very good judicial function. So, for example, half of SEBI's orders are overturned by the appellate tribunal. So we need to ensure that because there's going to be so much litigation on this issue in the first few years, that we do have a very good judicial arm of the NPDA. And the third is there have to be some sort of whistleblower protection, because I think any misuse of non-personal data is probably going to come from inside the organization. And in India, I don't think we have whistleblower protections of that extent. So I think this is how I would think of trust in each level of the framework. Now, to your questions of incentives for people to behave well, share data, etc., I think that's the key challenge here, which I'm still not able to wrap my head around. Because how do you, this basic question, how do you set a price for something that is non-excludable, is something that economists haven't answered. So I don't know how it will play out here, because you can't, if things like defense and air, you can't charge for those because it's non-excludable. One person gets it, the other person get it too. In this case, for example, if I'm the data requester, I get the non-personal data and nobody's monitoring it, so I just provide it to everyone else. Then on what basis am I paying in the first place, and why does anyone have any incentive to pay, right? One person can pay and then share it with everyone else in the ecosystem. And so I think it's a challenge, this question of pricing. There could be some sort of licensing regimes where you can only use the metadata if you have actually paid for it. But how do you enforce this licensing regime in a country like India is difficult to say. There have been lots of private sector models of data marketplaces, more on the personal data side. But those have also failed because of the difficulty of creating two-sided marketplaces. So I think that itself is a challenge. A lot of people regulators have used some sort of almost like a public funding of these kind of infrastructures, where, for example, the fines collected by a regulator are used to subsidize public good purposes like awareness, etc. One could imagine that kind of an incentive architecture for the NPDA, but will the NPDA really ever generate so much in fines that it will, and is that really the kind of mechanism and incentive we set for it that it has to do? So I think the key problem in this entire ecosystem map is this question of pricing and how do you price it appropriately, because in this framework, it does say that a data requester has to pay a fee to the data trustee, even though that will be a somewhat nominal fee. And finally, to bring it all together and answer your last question about the role of the data trustee itself and the NPDA and a lot of other structures in this case, I think public good has been defined in section 7.6 as saying that here are the 15 things like poverty alleviation, etc., which are public good, and there's a 16th which has and others. So that kind of ambiguity is never helpful in any kind of regulation. But more importantly, how do you ensure that a public good purpose is being served? So at the time of asking for the data, will a data requester have to say what it will use it for? Does the data trustee have any discretion in saying no to it? And if the data requester takes that data and does something completely different with it, is there any kind of recourse or not? All of these remain undefined in the current framework. I think it will be useful to tighten it, with given all the suggestions that I said before. I also think, given how important the role of the data trustee is, I think it will become important that the data trustee be financially independent of any other kinds of corporate or other interests, that it's not serving that. So I think the kind of data trustees who get the privilege of hosting an HVD also has to be defined far better. And finally, the overarching point that I will say is, look, given how much litigation this is going to result in, and I think it's natural, and I think the committee also acknowledges that jurisprudence will evolve, but who are the players who will have the financial wherewithal to actually fight those cases again and again and again will be a certain kind of company. So I'm not so sure that will the startups even have the management and financial bandwidth to actually fight out with the larger tech companies and therefore make this thing a success. So these are all questions. I think the heart's in the right place, but some of these nitty-gritties need to be detailed out a lot more.
It sounds like this will be a fair amount of there are so many of these big ticket questions that have not been answered. I can see this playing out for the next few years. But unlike GST, which has a much narrower mandate, this is a lot more open-ended and too many questions. So what is if the government of India is planning a step change in the ecosystem where one day it passes the law and then unleashes chaos in the world, what do you think would be a way to introduce this law? Discover what are appropriate institutions, processes, incentive structures, and so on. It's not as if like somebody will magically come up with these things overnight.
Yeah, in the discussions we've had previously within this group as well in preparing for this event, I think one of the suggestions was, can we start with the government data itself? And saying that you open up the government data, let's figure out how the system works with that kind of data and then scale it to private players as well. I think that's a good suggestion. I don't think there might be as much political appetite to do that. The alternative could be, do you want to open it up in a particular sector before you take a cross-sectoral view? So if you say that, look, in healthcare, for example, this is really important for us, or in education, it's really important for us, then let's do it in one sector. Figure out what are the problems in this kind of thing. I think it's really ambitious. So it's probably wise to start small and in a somewhat more controlled setting.
I think that's wonderful. This is a nice segue to a big domain that the committee has talked about often, which is transportation. they're very interested in transportation data. So we get to hear from an insider, Naresh, about how the ecosystem might react to this. Naresh Bharadwaj is a senior product, senior manager for product management at Zendrive, which is a transportation and insurance company. He will explain the context to us. He's a multidisciplinary product leader with over 11 years of experience delivering innovative and high-value consumer and SaaS products across product market fit, growth, maturity stages of the product life. That was a mouthful, but it really helps that he understands the domain inside out and actually built data products in this space. And there are a few key questions that I would like Naresh to touch upon, and in addition, share anything else that may be on it. The first thing is, what kind of data do you have that is of interest to the community overall, right? When they keep talking about transportation data or Uber data, what do they, what are they talking about? Second, if even companies like Uber have to share, what are the realistic challenges that they have, whether it is legal, technical, for example, are there multiple people who own the data simultaneously, and so on. The third thing is, if the transportation industry has to share this data, what are some things that it would look at to get back in return? In what way can it benefit from such a ecosystem? And of course, finally, if you were to introduce this kind of thing as a product, what are some thoughts that come to your mind? I think this is, take it from there.
Thank you very much, Venkat. I know that introduction was a mouthful, but I'm glad you went through it anyway. So I think transportation is interesting, and as a product manager in this space who's not only worked with Zendrive, where we deal with road safety and driver engagement use cases, I've also previously worked at Swiggy, where I've seen how we address some of the challenges that the delivery boys face on the road. So the first thing that one needs to understand when they're thinking about the transportation space is that we deal with location data and sensor data at scale. And you know, imagining them to be the building blocks, what we then have are certain aggregate results about users and their trips on a daily basis, right? These in a very blunt sense would be the units of interest, whether you're looking at an Uber or Swiggy or even at Zendrive. Now, when I think about all the challenges that an NPD kind of poses, I'll keep aside some of the commentary related to, you know, addressing the regulatory challenges, you know, having the capacity to also meet some of the expectations that the NPDA or a data trustee would have to some of the other panelists. I'll talk about perhaps some of the product and the engineering challenges as well. And I'll perhaps, you know, frame it in, you know, three different ways. You know, first, there are the costs of documenting and delivering non-personal data as per the expectations of the authority. Then you have the fact that different types of metadata need specialized treatment, not only in how they're stored, but how they're ingested, how they're secured. And then finally, I'd also want to perhaps talk about the most challenging of the problems that we face, which is metadata can reveal certain proprietary mechanisms which offer competitive advantages to companies which use this data for different use cases. So first I'll talk about the costs, right? I think it's become somewhat popular to imagine that data businesses harvest the last KB of data. I can emphatically say that that's not the case. Very often there are trade-offs made on a real basis where, you know, stale data is often purged, where, you know, the costs of storing and processing the data can exceed its purported benefits. And there are, of course, you know, different policies that different companies may have on how much data they wish to retain in a general sense. The draft report does not have anything in there which talks about how much data must be retained, what type of data may be of interest to them for a specific sector. You know, in our case, you know, we know location data must be treated differently. And then one other concern, you know, which is allied is, you know, we know that companies have created a lot of specialized infrastructures to deal with different types of data. Do we anticipate the data trustees to have the same level of sophistication, how they secure their data and, of course, you know, manage it in a general sense? I think all of that kind of comes through with the same argument. Then there's this realization that, you know, since GDPR, a lot of companies, transportation companies, have invested a lot of efforts into isolating personal and non-personal data. Now, through that, I think extreme care has been taken into how we could service the laws that exist in different countries. This specialized approach has told us, at least in the transportation ecosystem, that hey, location and sensor data require special infrastructure. I don't want to get into the technical details here, but it's not the same as storing, say, transactional data or even aggregated data of different forms. And I think it still is not clear to me on whether a trustee can independently arrive at the sort of designs some of us have in the transportation world for the durable infrastructure that we've set up to manage different types of non-personal data in the transportation world. And then in this sense, I think, you know, when I think about it, I do acknowledge that there is public utility to the data that the transportation companies have, but we need to ask ourselves the question on why do we want to recreate this infrastructure? And if we do want to recreate this infrastructure or, you know, leverage some which is already existing, should the existing data custodians also, in a sense, act as the trust beneficiaries? This might actually work because since, you know, defining the purpose of acquiring the data for a trustee, and then of course the HVD precedes the access of data, having some data custodians as beneficiaries might actually avoid certain principal agent problems related to commercialization of data and even data governance. Finally, I think, you know, the most pressing of challenges that that companies in the transportation sector would have would be regarding how certain types of metadata could offer a peek into what may offer competitive advantages to different businesses. I know, for instance, if we exhaustively catalog metadata, we would, at least, you know, for certain businesses and use cases that I've seen, offer a peek into the quality of data that we aggregate and offer to our customers as well. So there is nothing in the report which acknowledges this challenge. So I would want some perspective on how we could perhaps isolate that those parts of data which could be more valuable than others. Lastly, as a comment, Venkat, I have a slightly different view on the larger direction the world is going. I understand that the governments of the world are very keen on acquiring a certain sovereignty over data that is collected among the citizenry. But let's also acknowledge that we have giants like Apple and Google who control large platforms, who in many ways offer guidance and determine the direction in which the industry is moving. For instance, it's been clear to us in the transportation world over the last couple of years that a lot of the data processing that we do for location as well as sensor data is incentivized to happen on a device itself, right? So if you're using a smartphone and if, say, a certain piece of technology needs location data in order to improve a certain user experience, that need not happen through a server round trip. That can all happen on a device itself, which means increasingly we're going to see more and more data, more and more data restricted to a device, and perhaps only transactional data coming through to hit the servers. So in this universe, how ambitious can governments really be about extracting public utility from non-personal data when we have, you know, transportation companies also perhaps waiting for the blessings of big tech before they use it themselves? There's one other question I remember you asking me, as how do I think about it as a product manager. I think in the world of product management, we often talk about go-to-market, and then, you know, it's kind of something that we think about at the top of the engineering cycle. So if I were a government, I would wonder whether, you know, I can have, say, a small-scale experiment to validate all that I seek as goals through a small experiment with a small group of stakeholders from the industry before enshrining things in the policy itself. I think that would be my key suggestion as a product manager.
Yeah, that's all interesting. So what I'm taking away from everything that you said is that one is there are strong technology changes, there is a lot of complexity and sophistication in this infrastructure and so on. What I did not hear in this whole thing is one thing that would incentivize you as a transportation person to actually share the data. Is there nothing at all for you in this?
No, that's not true. So a lot of us are, you know, mission driven. You know, for instance, at Zendrive, we really care about road safety, and we realize that by enhanced public utility of the data that we have, we might ultimately improve the infrastructure upon which, you know, the data that we generate exists. So I see value, albeit value over a longer cycle, but there is public utility, and this of course is my point of view, but it's clear to me that the transportation industry will have data that will be of public utility.
Yeah, that's wonderful. So with that, I think both Prashant, Subhashish and Naresh, they're all talking about the capacity limitations in the system. So we'll move to a slightly different entity about which also we're going to talk, which is all these data businesses. Naresh, Zendrive being just one instance of it. So in order to give us a broader perspective, we have Mangalam. Thank you for waiting on us, trying to weave a thread around the many aspects of this. Mangalam Nandakumar is a principal consultant at ThoughtWorks. She has 18 years of experience in product management and software delivery. She is a published author, speaker, and is passionate about equitable and inclusive technology. So this is, you know, NPD should advance that objective for sure. Let's talk about some of the implementation challenges that we hinted at earlier. Mangalam, if you could talk about how best can we empower these data trustees from a technology standpoint, as well as the enterprises. What is the current state? Is every organization as sophisticated as Naresh's? Or what is the, when you look inside the enterprises, how do they look? Do they have the capacity to comply with the NPD laws? And thirdly, as far as the sharing of this data is concerned, Naresh hinted at it, but essentially we are looking at creating new data infrastructure, including cataloging, isolating, anonymizing, and so on. Is it realistic? Do companies have the capacity, or is there a need for public goods in the technology space to support NPD? What is your take?
Sure. Thanks, Venkata. I think it's my privilege to be part of this discussion, and it was not at all a problem waiting. I think wonderful opinions all around. Today, interestingly, is also World Data Privacy Day, so it makes it very interesting, actually. So to your question, right, initially on the data trustees and how they can be supported, I think a lot of good points that both Prasanto and Subhashish brought up, just in terms of the discretionary aspects of data trustee as an entity in this system, right, and how independently can they make these decisions, right? So the draft, of course, places like a lot of responsibility on data trustees. And this is not just looking out for the interests of the community that they serve, but also in terms of maintaining the HVD infrastructure, right? So for a Section 8 company to be able to do this, right, would they have the necessary capability, the capacity, and the expertise to pull off something like this? I think it seems a little impractical, but the outcome of it could be one or the other, right? One, if this entire thing proves to be an entry barrier, and then you just don't end up having the right kind of data trustees to begin with, right? Or you end up having these Section 8 companies partner with or be set up as proxies by some of the larger corporates, right? And then you have to start questioning in terms of whose interests are they really serving, right? So I think that that is a real concern, I would say. But I wanted to actually take a step back and look at data trustees in a different perspective altogether, and if that's possible, right? I think right now the draft looks at them as gatekeepers, right? So there's this data, let's protect it and let's make sure that it's providing the right benefit and not harming and so on. But what if we look at them more in the context of advisors, right? Taking a more forward-looking view rather than, you know, looking at today's state, but saying that, okay, here's data sets that need or that can empower these communities that probably don't exist today. Right. So can we actually promote and say that, hey, this is a data set that should probably be collected. Maybe that can foster some data collection happening to begin with. Right. Or another aspect that I think Subhashish brought up, which is purely in terms of their audit. Right. Like one part is audit, but also can they be the channel that publishes the insights in terms of what is the most frequently requested data? Right. Like what is the market looking like? And, we may have a lot of data from the transportation companies, but maybe that's not what people need, right? Maybe that's not what is spurring the innovation, right? In the public goods sector, maybe it's something else, right? And maybe we don't have the data. Or another aspect is just, providing insights on what a high value data is to begin with, right? So is it, metadata sets and everything, whatever is collected is in the context of the business that collected it to begin with. Right now, that may or may not necessarily constitute public good, but can trustees become the advisors in that context who's providing perspective on this and maybe decouple that whole administration of data to a different entity altogether? Right, I think that is at least my perspective. But assuming that trustees have to play that role of data administration, then I think there is definitely a lot of tech support, right? Like in terms of just understanding what metadata is. I think even large corporates sort of struggle with it, right? Like data governance is like is a huge aspect in itself. To expect Section 8 companies to suddenly overnight, wake up to this concept, I think that seems a little impractical. So there is definitely support that's needed for them as they ramp up on this journey, and that in a way that doesn't influence their overall, the objectives of why they exist in the first place. Leading to, I think your second question was in terms of enterprises itself, right? Like, are they equipped to deal with this? Yeah. And how, right?
So,
yeah. I think I'll make a sweeping generalization here, but I think businesses definitely are seeing data strategy is essential to their business agility, right? So I would go on to claim that businesses have probably been investing in their data strategy for a while now in the hope that they're going to reap benefits from those insights, right? That will help them steer ahead forward. Now, the thing is, I think a lot of the panelists here spoke about the incentives, right? Like what are the right incentives for a business to be even motivated to share this data? So the aspect of this whole monetization thing seems a little, damn squib to me, because data in that sense is not a commodity, right? It's an asset, right? So the value is not in just the sale of that raw data. It's about, what does that data give you in terms of insights? how timely are those insights, right? And how valuable is it to the context of the business that you're running? Now, and it gets magnified, right? So you're looking at your data set, it gets magnified when you combine it with a different data set and so on. So in that sense, if I look at it from a requester's perspective, it could be an all or none, right? I'm requesting a certain combination of data sets. And let's say one of those entities refuses to give me, is it still valuable data for me, right? Like, I think that's a different aspect. But in terms of enterprises, there is, if the carrot doesn't work, I'm guessing the stick does, right? So you would see they would potentially see this as a necessary evil, like a box to be checked. You know, if you have to survive as a business, you need to comply with this. It's almost like what GDPR does, right? Like you would do it for your own sake, but whether you would do it for benefiting another business or a public good sake, I don't think data monetization is the right incentive. I think at a bare minimum, we should at least look at removing all these unreasonable asks and demands, right? Like, for instance, let's say there is turnaround times. How soon is the business supposed to respond in terms of a data request, right? What happens, for instance, if they contest a request and say they don't want to provide this data? How long does it take for the matter to be resolved, right? And I think those are the aspects that would definitely concern larger businesses. And this is also important, I think, to look at the context in terms of businesses operating across multiple countries, right? So you're going to have to comply with multiple versions of privacy data policies, right? And then how do you reconcile those, and how do you actually, you know, this shouldn't become like one more burden that they need to deal with, right? And not just in, so my take is like incentives is one aspect, but also, you know, lowering that threshold of inconvenience, if I may say that, right? Like, I think that's equally important as well. You might have to repeat the third question for me. I couldn't keep track.
So in terms of just data quality and whether they're organized in a way that it can be, whether we, you know, we can't go back and clean the data, right? That's going to be really hard. So are they in a state that they can even be shared, assuming that we build some of this infra around it?
I think that is two things, right? One, so that I would say there are a few aspects to this. One is that initial cataloging itself, right? Are you able to catalog the data? Are you also, say, able to segregate the PII data from the non-PII ones, right? Like, all of that is, I think, essential. And then there is this question of, just in terms of, like, one is the cost of doing that, right? Like, you would be doing this internally, but then there are, let's say, other aspects to it. For instance, the data in the way that you use for your internal usage may or may not be the same way that you want to expose it for the purpose of NPD, right? So are you going to have to set up like a parallel infrastructure? The second part of it, I think, is in terms of data retention. Businesses, let's say, may have an internal policy of archiving everything every 6 months, right? Now, we don't know what the ask is in terms of NPD, right? Like, what if you're asked to maintain your data for the past 10 years? Right, like, so, and those are different significant changes in terms of how you business might want to approach their data strategy. The third aspect, I think, just in terms of sharing data itself, there are issues, right? The draft calls out innovation and entrepreneurship as a desirable outcome. Now, I think Naresh mentioned it as well. Speed to market is essential, right? So if you can't innovate when based on data that's 2 years hence, or you want it today and you're getting it 6 months later, that's, you know, as good as not having it, right? So where is that accountability in terms of the turnaround times? Just by reading the draft, it looks like multiple layers, right? Like the trustee takes some view and then goes to the request, you know, the data business, and then what if they reject, and then goes to the authority, you know, by that time. And really, do startups can actually, can they afford to stay that long in the game? Right, so that is one aspect. But the next is also in terms of accuracy itself, right? Quality. What if there are gaps in data, right? And so the metadata is one part of it, but let's say the timeline of data. I want the most recent one. Now, is the data business going to be willing to give more recent data? And then there is also the question of, you know, purely the quality itself of data. So who's going to be checking it or verifying it? Is it the trustee? Does the requester have to worry about it? And then how? What is my recourse, right? Like, how do I go back and ask for more data? So how does that process look like? And therefore, there is also, is this a one-time request? What does it look like when there is a more frequent, more than once type request versus real-time data request? Are those processes looking different, right? I think there are several aspects. And the last one, I think, which would concern enterprises in terms of data sharing, right, is enterprises are likely to, say, put in a lot of thought around cybersecurity and data protection and so on. Now, once you exposed your data to data requesters, what's the guarantee that the same level of diligence is there on the requester's side, right? And also, it's not just about, okay, they're using this data internally and they have, let's say, lax security, that is one risk. What stops them from, say, reselling that data, right? That's another aspect as well. And I think those will be the larger concerns. So
and we might even go towards adversaries. Much of the concerns, I mean, as somebody who lives in this trenches of data day in and day out, right, I recognize all the issues that you're talking about. We are running short of time. Prashant, I don't think anything that you have heard so far is shocking, surprising. I think you have heard this thing before. What do you see as the path forward?
You know, I think to step back to the 10,000 foot level, this is something again that has come up in discussions. You know, the question of is this a solution looking for a problem? Do we need this? Okay, and I think I'd just take a couple of examples from what has been said to summarize that. Naresh, for example, gave a very good example of the incentive question and said that safety, for example, is a driver. Now, if I take any of the other critical infrastructure areas, and by the way, transportation is one of the six. So take fintech, for example, the banking, financial services, fintech. Again, safety there is currently a very big driver. Okay, but having said that, there is a very strong regulator in that. In fact, there are more than one, but there is RBI to start with in the entire payments infrastructure space. There is a lot of data that RBI actually asks for. Now, each entity, each payment system operator would be very keen to be able to share data and collaborate, etc., to improve safety in the system. Okay, but it doesn't need to go through the future infrastructure of an NPD, HP data set framework for that. There is an existing framework, and that is under the regulatory oversight of the Reserve Bank of India. So therefore, in this overall framework, I remain unconvinced that we actually need this huge mega framework that we are going to and struggling with these questions and so on. So that is a very existential 10,000 foot question back onto this. And if it is done, and I suspect a lot of these things will just be done regardless, then I'm really looking forward to some of the transparency things, which I think Shubhashish also elaborated further on. Sorry, you're on mute.
I mean, it will be an interesting time for sure if we unleash this on the whole country. Any closing thoughts, Shubhashish, Naresh?
I'll probably come in with one, because I think a panel where everyone agrees is not a fun enough panel. So just to disagree a little bit with what Prashant just said, I think, again, putting my economic lens I do see the need for something like this, because data markets left to themselves, because of the nature of data that is non-excludable, the purely private market cannot emerge in those kind of settings. So I think there is definitely a nudge that is required to make data more freely accessible, to get to socially more optimal outcomes. Of all the possible options, is this the best one? Is, I think, one that is certainly up for debate, and clearly the committee in its report hasn't looked at evaluated other models for doing so. So I do see the need, and there I disagree slightly with what Prashant said, but I do broadly agree that is this the best possible way to achieve it? We don't yet know.
So there is one question from Shubhangi, I think from Kat. I'm not sure. Can there be incentives such as tax credits, viability gaps, gap funding for data custodians, and so on? Apparently, other jurisdictions have explored. Basically, is there a way to provide soft landing on the cost side, on the management, and so on, that you see can be put in place within NPDA framework?
So if I can just very quickly summarize, I mean, sure, I think incentives, the question is a good one, and it should be looked at in terms of what are the possible types of incentives that would work. But I doubt if the incentive part will be an overriding factor. You know, I started with examples like Amazon's overwhelming, potential dominance based on. Now, there is a reason why that is, that data is so valuable to it. So a little bit of an incentive here and there is not going to override the fact that, you know, there is very valuable data that it's going to fight to retain. So yes, if we are going ahead and doing this, then we must consider the incentive question. And that incentive can be public good, which these entities are part of. So safety is one, safety, security. And these are things which, by the way, directly benefit the players also. And fintech is an example. If you reduce the number of frauds from the level that we have seen happening in 2020 in the pandemic year, all the PSPs and PSOs will be actually happy. It's just that there are different ways of doing it.
Wonderful. I think we are slightly over our 1 hour budget that we have. Let me highlight a few things that came up during the conversation. One is, of course, all the different ways we can ensure trust in the system. We talked about various transparency mechanisms, feedback mechanisms, and so on. We also talked a little bit about the complexity of implementation at the NPD level itself, at the data trustee, as well as at the data business, and how we need a lot more tighter rules, a lot more narrower framing of this whole space in order for this to become manageable. I mean, potential, we looked at whether there could be incremental paths to this. Some of the sectoral approaches are possible. We can introduce some form of pricing and so on. The big thing seems to be that there is a lot of uncertainty along many different directions in this space. Scope, implementation, and especially in a country where the regulatory capacity is low. So it'll be interesting to see how this whole thing will play out. And of course, there could be new directions. Mangalam pointed out how data trustees could take a slightly different role, where they would actively engage the data custodian to advance the community interest. That is a much more of a positive, proactive